crowned regional champion, of course, Justin Bokari on your left. You've seen him go through the entire bracket so far, and he's made it this far. And then Colton Day, someone we haven't seen too much of yet, but has earned a spot in the finals as well. Justin, a very accomplished player. We've taken a look at some of his player accomplishments throughout the years. You know, he's constantly in that kind of top 16 race for various stipends. He has a regional championship win this season, of course, in San Diego, top four in Memphis last year. And of course, way back in 2008, more than 10 years ago, he does have a top 16 at the World Championship.
Yeah, Justin, a player who has been at the top level of the game for years and years. Someone who also has unfortunately been on that bubble many, many times. It's kind of been a running joke amongst his friend group of Justin getting ninth, bubbling out of cut. But this year, fortunes have turned into his favor, getting top four in Knoxville earlier on, winning, of course, San Diego, and finding himself once again in the finals here in Collinsville.
Yeah, on the other side of the table, we have Colton Day. Like we've said, longtime player from this area, has a top 32 at the Dallas Regional Championship this very year. He has the top 64 at the North American International Championship in 2017, just a few years ago. And again, you know, showing that he may not play every single event, but he does have very good top 16 U.S. Nationals back in 2015 and 2016, the predecessor to the North American International Championship. Very impressive runs. You know, does not have the great huge runs Justin has, but has consistently throughout time performed well, and now he's here looking to name himself a regional champion.
Yeah, not necessarily the most regionals accomplishments, but those three internationals slash national championship accomplishments are huge. Traditionally, U.S. Nationals before internats happened was always the toughest tournament of the year, largest tournament, and being able to make top 16 at that twice in a row, a huge achievement.
And a whole lot of Pokemon prize over on Colton's side, a whole lot of item cards over on Justin's side. Do you think anything in the prizes you see that stands out to you might kind of hurt either player?
I mean, nothing terrible. The second item lock Vileplume with Irritating Pollen could be pretty bad for Colton if Justin's able to take that first one out right away, and it is up at the top of the prize card. So if Colton does take his prizes in kind of the traditional fashion, he might have a hard time finding that.
And it looks like we do see the handshake. These players are off. One of them will become a regional champion. Looks like Colton is going first.
Yeah, he did draw for turn, has a couple of Oddish in play, gets the power plant down. That could definitely slow Justin, but Justin top decks a Skyfield actually. Right away, he's going to be able to draw some cards.
Yeah, gets rid of the power plant. Of course, Colton could not play a supporter on turn one. We're going to see Justin hopefully have a big explosive turn. He's a really important factor is that Justin needs to get rid of all of these item cards. He needs to use them as quickly as possible, as those are not going to be, he's not going to have access to them throughout much more of the game.
We've seen it in Justin's games throughout this weekend. His deck can definitely pop off on the first turn. I would certainly expect him to thin his deck very well of items to where he's not going to be as effective by that Vileplume. One important factor as well, though, is that there's another Vileplume Justin has to be mindful of. Disgusting Pollen will prevent basic Pokemon from attacking, so that Garbotoxin Garbodor that Justin plays will be an important piece.
Yeah, that's really the way. Is that really the only way for Justin out is to just make sure he sets up that Garbodor to turn off the abilities of those Vileplumes?
I mean,
he can't really play around it any other way.
He can attack with the Muk. That is about his best option. And I've seen it happen before in some of these matchups. Muk is an evolution, so you can do some damage. It does cost 4 energy in order to do it. Its attack crunch, I believe, only doing 90 damage. So not even a one-hit KO once you do get those 4 energies. Justin's setting up pretty well here. I think exactly what he wants to go for is going to be that Horror House GX.
It looks like he's playing an Ultra Ball here, eyeing down a Phoebus, just again, kind of setting himself up. He does have the ability to play a supporter this turn because he's going second. And if you've watched any of the top 8 or top 4 matches he was involved in, he is going to try to have these explosive turns. But does anything change because he's playing against this deck? Is he going to be, like, we know he wants to get through a lot of his deck, but is he still just basically on the plan of, I want to play Shaymin, I want to play Dedenne, I just want to get through as much as I can?
Yeah, I think that generally his strategy is going to be the same as he draws this hand of 6, and it is not going to yield him very much. But yeah, overall, I would say the same strategy. He wants to try to get through the deck as quickly as possible, use Horror House GX here on turn 1, and then set up to turn 2, Ace Trainer his opponent to a 3-card hand, and then use Trevenant and Dusknoir's attack to limit 2 of those cards and leave your opponent with just that 1-card hand. And I mean, there's a chance if Justin's able to pull that off, he could win in just a couple turns.
So we don't see quite as explosive of a hand from Justin, but we do see a Battle Compressor. Like you see these deck, this deck basically just play Battle Compressor as often as possible in the early turns, execute the immediate card taken, and then Professor Juniper and Weakness Policy as well.
Yeah, cards that are just not going to be useful. I mean, putting Juniper down might seem questionable since Item Lock will turn off the Versus Seekers, won't be able to access Professor Juniper, but he does still have a turn of items, theoretically.
All right, and there's the Floatstone on the Ditto Prism Star. Gengar and Mimikyu becomes active, and there is the Horror House GX. Colton really, you know, just has to draw his card and pass the turn back.
What a top deck. Justin gets the Versus Seeker, and with no other playable cards in his hand, that's exactly what he needs. I mean, he can't Ace Trainer because he's not down on prizes yet, so he's not going to get the perfect combo off, but will still be in a pretty solid spot.
And there's the Floatstone on the Dedenne, and there's the Versus Seeker for the Juniper. That is why you Battle Compressor as Justin did, and now he gets seven fresh cards.
I wonder if he'll even, since he's not, you know, going to get that perfect lock, he might even just go for a Poltergeist here. Oddish does only have 60 HP, so as long as Colton has two trainers in hand, it will be a one-hit KO, and it does look like he has attached another energy.
Yep, second energy on the Gengar and Mimikyu, just considering how he wants to play out the rest of his hand. Of course, he does still have to be fearful of items. Looks like an Ultra Ball is going to be the play from Justin, just continuing to develop his board out, rather.
Yeah, he does have a Shaman in hand, so he can draw a bunch with that. We could see him just grab the Milotic, go ahead and get that in play, or even get a Trevenant and Dusknoir, throw it down onto the bench, potentially.
Yeah, he looks like he's eyeing up a Phoebus, but he's just going back and forth. Does decide to pick the Phoebus, of course. Justin, also one thing to notice, he's been playing this deck, obviously, to this position. We've watched him just play really, really good throughout top eight and top four. He's not going to be a guy that makes a lot of mistakes. He's going to, especially at this level where you're playing for, you know, the title of regional champion, all the money and all the prizes that go along with that. So we do see that second Phoebus hit the board, yeah, and now a Shaman.
Justin, certainly a player who is calculated in all of his actions. That is three VS Seekers.
Three VS Seekers. What was that? Tapu Lele was the last card?
Yeah, that's, man, that is not what Justin was looking to find here.
Yeah, Justin not exactly going off as much as he would have liked here. We've consistently seen, it sounds weird to say this, as Justin is sitting in the finals playing for the title of regional champion, but we've seen his hands be pretty awkward. We've seen his top decks from his opponents be pretty awkward. He's definitely fought through a lot to get here.
I mean, one thing drawing all these Versus Seekers does do for Justin is that he can play them before a potential item lock comes out, so he at least gets use out of them, but, I mean, he really wanted to be drawing more cards here, I feel like, and having to discard too many supporters or too many Versus Seekers too early could cause issue.
And so now we're going to see an Ultra Ball. Looks like retaining all of those Versus Seekers in his hand, just getting a Shaman here, doing some more setting up.
And I think especially playing these Versus Seekers will work out in the long run, since Justin knows he's not going to be limiting Colton's hand too much, since he was not able to pull off that Ace Trainer play. He finds Computer Search.
Yeah, Computer Search, Guzma, Shaman EX was the draw here. So he's going to go ahead and propagate before Computer Searching. Goodbye, Guzma. Goodbye, Execute.
And it gets any one card out of his deck. Will want to find, I mean, he can set up any piece. Oh, going to find Rescue Stretcher. Needs to put back those Milotics.
Yeah, discard those Milotics early, as well as the Garbodor, which we talked about a little bit, the importance of that card. So Rescue Stretcher was kind of the obvious choice there. Just kind of resetting these resources and making sure he has access to these very powerful setup, helpful Pokemon in the later turns.
A kind of tricky thing here for Justin is that he's going to need to be sure that he plays, uses the Milotic before he puts Garbotox and Garbodor in play. Otherwise, he won't have access to the Milotics through the rest of the game unless we see something like a Faba from Colton to get rid of that tool on Garbodor.
Yeah, the sequencing can be really important there. I've seen players accidentally lock themselves out of things like that using Wobbuffet, using Garbodor. You just have to be really careful that you can not have to commit one to the board before the other. We are seeing a Poltergeist here.
Yeah, and that's a lot of trainers. So.
Yeah, I think that'll be enough to take the knockout on the Oddish there.
Poor little Oddish. And a pretty good top deck there from Colton, able to find a Netball. This can grab either a basic grass Pokemon or a basic grass energy.
Yeah, and it looks like this will be Colton's first kind of full turn of the game. You know, he went first, of course, but couldn't play supporters, and then got Horror House GX the following turn. So this is the first turn Colton can play where he's kind of unrestricted in what he can do.
And we'll have to see what Colton does as far as which Vileplume he goes for in this instance. Probably, honestly, a little fortunate on Colton's part that he didn't get fully locked out of the game. You know, there wasn't much he was doing to hinder Justin's setup. Justin just didn't quite draw what he needed in order to get there. But also interesting on Justin's side, I don't think he played any of those Versus Seekers.
No, I think he has them all left in hand unless I missed something. It looks like the netball is going to go ahead and grab that tag team, and then we're going to go just see a simple switch.
Yep, Tate and Liza, one of those great supporters that has two options on it. You can either shuffle your hand into your deck and draw five cards, or switch your active with one of your benched Pokemon, doing that right away, and it looks like Irritating Pollen will be the choice for Colton.
Yeah, so no items being able to be played on either side here, which is going to hinder Justin's setup quite a bit. We talked a lot about how he's a pretty item-reliant deck, though he does have a lot set up so far.
I mean, there's a chance a Poltergeist could hit pretty hard. I'm not sure how many cards are in Colton's hand, but he could definitely do a reasonable chunk of damage to two-hit KO this tag team Pokemon.
It looks like Justin, considering his options here, again, item cards are not to be played. Consulting the discard pile, he does have that Milotic, but I don't think there's many energy left in there. Just going to go ahead and take a second to think about what he wants to do here. He should also have, like, basically perfect knowledge of Colton's hand because I think he top-decked the ball, right?
Right, yeah. He saw everything that Colton has access to, so he knows about the Fava. He knows that the AZ is in hand, so any damage done here, he knows can just get erased effectively by this AZ, but it will just be another Poltergeist dealing 200 damage.
Yeah, sometimes you just have to kind of push and make your opponent use their resources when you know you don't really have much else going on.
The draw for Colton finds him a Cynthia and Caitlin. Really a great innovation from these Rowlett Exeggutor decks. We saw it from Gibson in the top eight of Dallas using Cynthia and Caitlin. I feel like this is a deck that really would have loved to have used Lusamine, of course, a card that's recently been banned from the expanded format. Cynthia and Caitlin, not quite as good, just getting you back one card, one supporter card, but it does draw you three.
Yeah, it looks like that's exactly what has happened here. Colton just filling his hand, but doesn't have a way to set up the other Vileplume.
And he just passes back over to Justin. And, I mean, after using Cynthia and Caitlin, his hand is much larger. Choosing to play Cynthia and Caitlin over utilizing AZ means that this Rowlett and Alolan Exeggutor will be knocked out, and that'll be three prizes for Justin.
So, game one is halfway over here, of course, where Justin just two prizes remaining. Vileplume is all Colton has left on his side.
And something we do know, Colton did prize that other Vileplume. So if this one goes down, he won't have the option to re-lock these items on Justin's side.
Looks like Bridget is going to be the play for Colton here, just kind of saying, okay, now I need to kind of reset back up. We talked a little bit about how the Bridget decks didn't have the best presence here compared to past expanded tournaments, but in a situation like this, when you're playing this specific deck where you can kind of buy more time, the specific number of turns matters a lot less.
I guess something relevant that we should mention for Justin is the fact that you know, he does have the Garbatox and Garbodor as well as the Wobbuffet. So he does have options as far as turning back on the ability to play items. So Versus Seeker is still a live card for him. Probably why he decided to hold on to them as opposed to playing them preemptively. Gives himself the most options moving forward.
Yeah, there are some decks that are just basically have no ability to deal with the Vileplume. Justin's deck is not one of them. He does have a lot of options here. You know, remains to be seen when you cut yourself off of items, or when you're cut off of items, rather, you don't always have the ability to find those pieces as easily as you might. So it's not a guarantee, but he does have a lot more options than most decks in the format.
We did see the Execute hit the bench from Colton. Could he be looking to slow things down with a blockade? That Executor is in hand, so I wonder if there's some sort of play where he brings a Pokemon that can't attack very quickly up to the active spot and hope that he locks it up.
Yeah, Execute. Again, usually just something you see going into the discard pile of these players, making it so they have to discard fewer resources. But with Colton, he's actually just ready to evolve and attack with it.
Yeah, only one turn remaining here. Let's see what Colton has. Gonna use that Irresistible Aroma ability from the Gloom. Let's him flip a coin, and if heads can choose a card, a Pokemon from his opponent's hand and put it onto the bench.
We did get a Tails there. We see an evolution into the Exeggutor and an energy attachment.
He does have a Steven's Resolve, so he could play that to pick any three cards out and just hope that Justin doesn't have the Guzma to close the game out. But it looks like he'll just use Tate and Liza for the other effect, shuffling in to draw five.
Yeah, just we've seen him use Tate and Liza for the switch effect. Now he's just doing the raw drawing cards effect, just needing to get something here to keep him in this game.
All Justin's going to need, though, is a Guzma, and for Colton to have a few energy cards, or excuse me, a few trainer cards, and it is going to be a super growth.
And again, that other item lock Vileplume is prized, so we're not going to see that come out. So now Justin has access to his entire deck.
Executor does have 100 HP, so still only needing two trainers in hand to be a knockout with Poltergeist. I think Justin, yeah, with items turned back on, doesn't even need like Garbodor or something like that, and can use Propagation, gets rid of that Execute once again to bring down Trevenant and Dusknoir. If he has VS Seeker for Guzma, I think he should just be able to win the game here.
Looks like he's going to go ahead and promote into that Ditto Prism Star, blow up the Milotic, load up the Trevenant and Dusknoir.
And there's a VS Seeker. There is a Guzma, I believe, in the discard pile that will bring up the Exeggutor, and 150 damage will be the knockout, and Justin is awarded the win in game number one.
Justin Beccari just one game away from being crowned regional champion. We might see a third interview with him at the desk here. So he's won the top eight and top four matches on camera, but Colton still has a lot to play for as well. That game did not exactly go Colton's way. Justin was able to just kind of set things up and roll through, as you saw, but there's still a lot of Pokemon left to be played. You see just over an hour remaining on our timer, so Colton's gonna have to rattle off two game wins if he wants to be regional champion.
Yeah, a less than 15 minute victory for Justin Beccari, and I think he would be just as happy if that game if game number two goes exactly how game one went.
Yeah, of course. That's exactly the kind of thing he wants. Is he wants to be able to say, okay, you have item lockup, but I have this kind of advantage already on you. I'm just kind of taking early prizes, and I have already set up my board. I don't necessarily need to go through my deck and find a bunch of stuff that would require using items.
Yeah, and kind of the surprise for me in that one is that Poltergeist was such a big impact. He didn't draw the pieces he needed in order to pull off Nightwatch with the Trevenant and Dusknoir tag team GX. Opted to go with Gengar and Mimikyu because that's just kind of how his hand was dealt to him, and it worked out. This deck from Colton does play a ton of trainer cards at 31, so Poltergeist does account for all items, all supporters, and stadium cards in your opponent's hands.
And it shows you the power of the Trevenant and Dusknoir deck, where you have this, the way you want to win the game is using this kind of handlock combo, but you definitely have other options, including just attacking for damage and taking prizes.
Ooh, a potentially important prize here for Justin Beccari is that Garbotoxin Garbodor, so a disgusting Pawling Vileplume would actually be really tough for him to deal with, and he would potentially be forced to attack with either Bide Barricade Wobbuffet or that Alolan Muk.
And we see game two is underway. Justin is going first. He does open with that Bide Barricade Wobbuffet. Just kind of planning out his turn now. We just have some options to play in his hand. On Colton's side, we do see that he has the Bridget and, of course, the Rowlet and Alolan Exeggutor, so he will be able to kind of execute his turn two strategy as he wishes.
Yeah, kind of just what we were talking about before the game got underway, that we thought whoever got to choose would choose to go second in this matchup. Justin either wants to, you know, be able to play a supporter, draw through as much of his deck as possible, and Colton wants to get that turn one super growth into a item lock Vileplume.
Of course, because he's going first, no supporters allowed for Justin, but he does have cards like Computer Search, Ultra Ball. You know, we've seen Justin's, whether he's going first or second, really, his hands have just been trying to draw as many cards as possible, get through as much of his deck as possible. And turn one, you know, he can't use a supporter, so he's a little bit behind in that sense, but still has a lot of options.
Yeah, Computer Search, a really big card here for Justin. He's got a Shamaniacs in hand, but he did start that Wobbuffet, so setup is not going to be an option for him. Computer Search will find him a Floatstone, though, so he can move this Wobbuffet to the bench and use setup in order to draw some cards.
Yeah, and there is a Phoebus, again, a really important part of the combo of the strategy of Justin's deck. That needs to hit the bench early and often, just give him out to that Milotic to really execute what he wants to do.
Yeah, and this is a great card to be able to retreat into here, because once it does evolve into a Milotic, it kind of gives you that retreat option once again, since by knocking it out, you have to promote a new Pokemon.
And again, some decks you might worry about the Phoebus getting knocked out, but that is not something that's going to happen here with Colton's deck. That's not really what the Rowlet and Alolan Exeggutor deck is about. They just want to lock you out of the game in the early turns.
Well, I mean, if one of these Oddishes has like a 20 damage attack for a grass, and Colton had an Oddish plus a Tate and Liza in hand, I mean, he actually could take a knockout on this thing. Phoebus does only have 30 HP, and it is weak to grass.
Yeah, it definitely could happen.
So it's one of those things. It could come down to which Oddish Colton chose to play in his list.
We do see the Battle Compressor coming down. Execute two psychic energy in the discard pile. Now we're going to see Justin, now that he's refilled his hand with that Shaman, kind of go through all the items again, thinning out his deck, getting through as much of it as possible, getting rid of all of these items, and trying to make sure that he is, you know, as Vileplume proof as he can be for the future turns.
Absolutely. Wants to play as many items as possible and just get through as much of the deck as he can. I'm sure he wouldn't mind playing almost all of the Battle Compressors in his list just to thin out all these cards that he knows he does not want to draw anymore.
Shaman off the quick wall makes a lot of sense. Again, these are early turns. They're just about as drawing as many cards as possible. He does have that Garbotoxin Garbodor in the prize card, so that's not going to be an option. That's something he would love to set up early with like a Ditto Prism Star, but it's not going to happen this game.
So this is pretty heads up here from Justin. He's actually going to keep a quick ball in hand. I think a lot of players here would just go ahead and use Execute, grab a Trevenant and Dusknoir and put it on the bench, but Justin's leaving himself the option to be able to continue to draw cards by keeping the quick ball in hand. If he wasn't to draw something like a Shaman or a Dedenne or an Ultra Ball, he can still get through more of the deck by having access to that quick ball.
Right, he's just saying, I know I'm going to draw one less card here, but this one card gives me the out to so much more.
Right, absolutely.
And that's exactly what happens here. We do see now we're seeing the quick ball for the Trevenant and Dusknoir. He does have a Dedenne in hand.
Yeah, so it ends up kind of being the same thing as if he had, you know, gone and grabbed it beforehand. And just left himself with the option just in case he didn't draw into one of those pieces off of the Shaman's setup.
Yeah, for sure. Just definitely one of those things that is small, but it's going to increase your percentage of winning just a tiny, tiny bit every time. And, you know, over the whole course of the tournament, how much of small plays added up like that to Justin's success.
We will see. Floatstone, not sure where he wants to put it quite yet. Going to opt for the Trevenant and Dusknoir.
And just has to pass the turn back to Colton now. That Rowlet and Alolan Exeggutor tag team in the active spot. Bridget looks like it'll be the play for Colton. This deck just highly reliant on kind of flooding the bench with Oddishes. And I also execute potentially on Colton's side. And just super growing into the Vileplumes to kind of just lock his opponents out of the game.
Yeah, pretty great draw here for Colton to have Bridget in his opening hand. He did prize one of his two copies, so in order to have, I mean, that's the ideal turn one supporter here. It searches for everything you need, leaves yourself with the most options, and having one in his opening hand after one being prized is exactly what he wanted to see.
It looks like he's taking a look to consult his hand versus his deck, you know, see what's left. Looks like two Oddishes and an Execute are going to be what he finds. Trying to memorize his price cards there, of course, as well.
Yeah, these great players, you'll see it all the time at this level. Want to check their prizes, want to look through the deck to see if they can tell what they have access to. Not necessarily memorizing all six, but just checking for, like, what is important for this specific matchup. So noting what they have access to through the rest of the game.
Absolutely. You see how important these early kind of first few turn decisions are for Colton. He's kind of referencing his hand, going back to his deck, picking which Vileplume he'll find, you know, how this will all work out. Just he doesn't have a whole lot of decisions to make every turn, but how he kind of orchestrates the game is very, very important.
And he does choose to mix things up here compared to the strategy he went for in game number one. Went right for item lock, this time going for Disgusting Pollen. So if Justin wants to deal with that with Garbotoxin Garbodor prized, he's going to have to start attacking with Alolan Muk.
Yeah, it does not prevent Justin from, you know, playing those item cards exactly, but can cut off a kind of a different angle of attack, literally in this sense. We see Milotic Phoebus evolves into Milotic on Justin's side.
Oh, Justin's already used his Rescue Stretcher, and I believe the Alolan Muk is in the discard pile. So now his only way to hit into this Disgusting Pollen Vileplume is going to be with Wobbuffet's Psychic Assault attack.
Looks like we are seeing the Milotic get used. Those energies are going on to the Trevenant and Dusknoir, and then we're seeing a Guzma play, bringing up the Oddish and before a Dedenne change for six fresh cards.
Yep, really great sequence of events here for Justin. Able to draw more cards and get a gusting effect. This is going to lock Colton out of the option of finding item lock next turn. This does, however, limit the Ace Trainer play, so he's not going to be locking his hand necessarily.
Yeah, had to use the Guzma there. This is not the kind of the traditional way that you'll see this turn play out. Colton with, it looks like maybe five cards in hand, so still going to be left with some options.
Justin checking through the deck here. I think he definitely has to be wary of how many energy he has left. I mean, Psychic Assault is going to be his only option to attack into this Vileplume, and it only does 10 damage. The attack doing 10 plus 10 more for each damage counter on your opponent's active Pokemon. So it'll take several turns to deal with this Vileplume. And, of course, Colton does have healing options when it comes to things like AZ.
Yeah, this is kind of the game that Colton wants to play going forward. He just wants to say, I'm attacking you from multiple angles. Your basics can't hit this Vileplume. You can't play items. You can't kind of get, you can't play Verse Seekers to get your Guzmas back and play around. I just kind of want to play this slower game in which I'm just kind of making you not be able to play. Whereas Justin, interestingly, is saying, well, I want to take the cards out of your hand. You know, I'm leaving you things on the board. I'm leaving you with the top card of your deck, but I want to kind of attack from a different angle. And both of these decks are looking to prevent their opponents from playing the game in one way or another.
Justin here playing a compressor, thinning those items like we mentioned. Weakness policy, of course, something that's just going to be totally useless at this point. Colton doesn't have anything that's going to be hitting for weakness on any of Justin's Pokemon. And setup's going to keep on drawing.
Four fresh cards, a couple of Versus Seekers, and a Floatstone and a Psychic Energy for Justin.
And I think, yeah, it looks like we'll see a proactive play of the Versus Seeker this time. And just a Night Watch, removing two cards from Colton's hand. Let's see what he gets rid of. Looks like it's actually a Guzma and a Cynthia and Caitlin.
Yeah, so two supporters gone. We did see that Versus Seeker for the Guzma from Justin, just saying, you know, you might be able to get a item lock Vileplume up, so you usually don't kind of see that play. You usually reserve your Versus Seeker for the supporter you're going to play that turn. Of course, Justin has already used his.
Yeah, I think wanting to make sure that he leaves himself the ability to get this Wobbuffet back active in order to play any of these item cards. So I wouldn't be surprised if we saw him go like Guzma, bring up Wobbuffet, and then via Seeker versus Seeker for Guzma once again if Colton's able to set up another item lock. But yeah.
We do see the disgusting Pollen Vileplume become the active Pokemon here for Colton.
And I mean, honestly, Colton's in kind of a situation where he could just hide behind this disgusting Pollen Vileplume as long as he doesn't bench, you know, five more prizes for Justin to take, which he has just done by benching another Execute. He could actually just win the game as long as Justin's not able to deal with this.
Yeah, this is, again, we're in a situation where there are some decks that just completely fold to this Vileplume. Justin's deck is not one of them, but he definitely can't execute his optimal strategy versus it. He has to play in a kind of different way that could buy Colton just enough time.
And especially with that Garbodor being prized and the Alolan Muk hitting the discard pile already. So, I mean, Colton, if he kind of realizes this, could still AZ one of these Pokemon on the bench and leave himself with just this Vileplume in play and start attaching to it. And, I mean, Downer Shock is the attack. Will be able to take a knockout on Wobbuffet in two hits before Wobbuffet's able to do too much.
Yeah, it just depends on kind of how Colton wants to sequence the game there. But he is choosing for now just to hide behind the Vileplume and say, okay, it's kind of on you to make these plays to deal with this. Otherwise, I'm just going to sit here and kind of wall behind it.
I wonder if we could even see Justin utilize this Guzma here to bring up the Alolan Exeggutor, try to get a hit on it before it, before you know Colton's able to start powering it up with some energies. He is going to play Guzma, but it's actually going to be the Execute he targets.
He's throwing that Wobbuffet as expected and attaching to it, so he does see kind of the writing of the wall of how this Execute is going to have to perform for him. We do see another Versus Seeker for the Guzma.
Yep. No item lock plume in play at the moment, so going to go ahead and utilize that in case that were to come into play in the future. And Nightwatch will pick up this knockout and gets rid of two supporters once again as Justin is able to draw another prize card.
Yeah, didn't quite see what was gotten off the Stevens resolve there, if those two supporters were involved in it. I don't think so. So I think kind of the card that Colton chose with the Stevens resolve are safe, which is good for him. And of course, he has a whole handful of cards. Unlike some of Justin's other opponents, Justin was not able to kind of get off the strategy he wanted to in this game.
Colton does have a computer search in hand. I wonder if computer search could go find him the AZ and he could pick up this Alolan Exeggutor Tag Team GX, leaving himself by not having all these extra prizes in play.
Looks like he is going to play the computer search, propagating first, of course, and then execute and Brock's Grid. hitting the discard pile.
We'll have to see what he grabs with this.
Yeah, this computer search choice is big. It will tell us kind of how Colton expects to play out the rest of the game.
Yeah, this game is already certainly going much better for Colton than it did in the first game. It really felt like kind of a sweep on Justin's side. Was able to take care of things rather quickly. And so Colton much more in this one. We'll have to see how he navigates the remaining turns.
Looks like Team Flare Grunt is pulled to the front of Colton's deck, you know, kind of showing that he might be expecting to take that. Also, Taten Liza, it looks like.
I'm wondering what he's thinking with this. He does have Exeggutor plus Recycle Energy in hand, so he may be thinking he wants to bring that up and start using Blockade, but that would just get knocked out by a Nightwatch right away.
Looks like he went for a Guzma here. We do see the evolution into the Exeggutor. We do see the attachment, and we're going to see the Guzma on the Ditto Prism Star.
Yeah, I'm going to bring this up. I think just blockading. Colton knows that the only way Justin could retreat this would be by attaching an energy to it to move it. He can't use Guzma to move it to the bench, and he can't use Mallow and Lana. He does find a Floatstone, however.
Yeah, he does have the item lock is not up, so right. He does have the Floatstone there, able to just retreat. Going to go ahead and take away Colton's card. Now Colton has played himself down to two cards, so now the kind of full lock will be up. He will have zero cards left and just be relying on the top of his deck.
Yeah, on the top of his deck. He gets the Recycle Energy back.
Oh, he does get the Recycle Energy back. Correct.
So we'll see. I mean, I don't know how helpful that's going to be to him at this point. He does have Execute in the discard pile as well. I wonder if he could have played around this by, like, utilizing the Execute, bringing it to the hand so that if that's, like, one more piece, Justin could shuffle back in, you know? But I don't think his two cards that he had in hand were super helpful to him anyway.
Yeah, all the cards are just kind of weren't relevant besides the fact that they're just cards in hand. And with the Execute being in the discard pile is kind of the same thing.
Yeah. We will see a Propagation. Quick Ball will discard that. Colton does play a copy of Tapu Lele. I do believe it was in the prizes, though, so that's not going to be an option to find AZ.
It looks like he is pulling that AZ to the front. But yeah, as we know, that Tapu Lele is prized, so he's just going to go ahead and check through once more, just making sure if he can do it or not. He realizes he cannot, and he just takes an Oddish.
Yeah, I think he was kind of thinking through wanting to find the Lele, gets the bad news, it's in the prize cards, forced to take an Oddish, and Justin Beccari, with only three prize cards remaining, definitely feels like he is in a good spot in this one, but it's certainly not over.
Yeah, Colton just hasn't really... He found the early Vileplume, chose to go with the Disgusting Pollen one, and hasn't really locked Justin out of much. He did have that Versus Seeker Guzma plays over and over again to take prizes, and it without any cards in hand, no item lock Vileplume up. It seems like this might be Justin's regional to win. We see the Guzma on the tag team.
Yeah, and this is a great play. It's going to be a two-hit KO on this Rowlett and Alolan Exeggutor, and it's going to be, does Colton top deck an AZ or not? Even something like a Guzma, you would think, could save him. Oh, there's a Team Flare Grunt.
Does have the Team Flare Grunt.
And shows Justin has the energy. That's it. Justin Beccari becomes your 2020 Cullensville Regional Champion, taking the tournament down with his Trevenant and Dusknoir Melodic deck.
Wow, so the whole tournament, especially the second day here, has been about these long, drawn-out games. We had the top four match with Colton and his opponent. It took so long, we had to take multiple parts to kind of, we were going to explain to you why it was taking so long. We've been talking about stall decks and game decks are trying to slow down the game.
Yeah.
And then in the final, Justin just comes in. It's two very quick games, just is able to execute his strategy perfectly. And this game has those Guzmas, chains them together, and becomes regional champion.
Two-time regional champion already this season as a player who found himself on the outside looking in so often in the past couple of seasons. You know this means so much to Justin. Getting those two victories, that nice glass to put on the shelf. Of course, the 5K doesn't hurt either.
Of course.
And those coveted championship points. This is definitely going to propel him forward in the stipend race and in the top 16 day two of Worlds race.
Yeah, congratulations to Colton as well.
Absolutely.
You know, making it all the way to a regional finals is nothing to be sad about. Of course, when you lose from this position, you lose such a high leverage match. It always stings a little bit, but you can go home knowing, you know, hey, I have a trophy too. It's a second place. I won some cash too. I did pretty well. But Justin Beccari is your regional champion. We've been following him all the way from his top eight match down to his top four. We've seen his executor strategy. We've seen his opponents draw out of it. We've seen him had to, you know, attack with Poltergeist a bunch and use different things. And he just knows his deck inside and out, has mastered the strategy. And, you know, it really paid off. He's regional champion now.
Yeah, absolutely. And hey, I really want to know what's going through the champion.